You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Webcams are looking stupid now as well. I hate technology. Right, there may be a green line when I'm speaking. I'll be fine. It's all right. It won't affect the audio. This is going to stay in. Anyway, right. So, welcome to the SWM podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I am joined on this edition of a new face in Scottish wrestling, a new face in Scottish professional wrestling, especially in the women's division. I am joined by Kate Calloway. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Thanks for having me.
I'm looking forward to this. May be a very interesting edition if we had an update beforehand, which delayed me getting the link to you. Somehow my camera's now going all funky. So this could be a very, very interesting hour. but anyway, we'll get the cliche questions in, and then we'll just spin off into whatever tangents we find for the next hour or so, as long as everything continues to work. As long as the internet's still on, should be okay. Possibly the most chaotic, having barely started, and it's probably going to be the most chaotic edition that I've had this year. And I had Ian Skinner for 2 hours speaking about Starship Troopers. So, you know, it's going to be a wild ride. So, yeah, we've got you on. And the first question is always the same for first-time guests is, how did you get into wrestling? So what was the moment that you became a fan of professional wrestling?
I was a fan when I was a kid because my stepdad watched it a lot. So I watched it. I must have been 8 or 9, maybe. So I would get it recorded on like a videotape. They would record it at night because it was too late for me to stay up. So then after school, I would watch it. And it was Batista was my main guy. So as soon as he was on, I was like, oh, hi. Like, he was my favorite. And then watched it myself when I was like a teenager and then fell out the end of high school into university. But then I think third year of university, started watching again, got into it more, and then started going to independent shows up in Scotland, and then decided to do it.
So go back to the start then, VHS, or it was videotapes, for those that are unaware, I didn't think you'd be someone who would know what VHSs are, to be perfectly honest.
Near the end, but
yeah, okay,
that's
yeah.
Excellent. Back in the day.
So you had to rewind them yourselves, people. You had to do that yourself. Or if you were, like, I don't know why it was a thing. Instead of doing it in the VHS player, you take a pencil and just, like a cassette and just do it back yourself. And
yeah.
Didn't really keep them a good shelf life. So you just got the shows. You got SmackDown, Raw, pay-per-views.
I didn't really get pay-per-views, but it was mostly the weekly shows. If the record worked, then I got to watch it.
If they took the tab out before putting it in, so Batista then, so 2005-ish we're talking.
Yeah, later on. About there. I'm never good with the dates, but I just remember about Batista time, about 2008-2009, I think.
All right. Oh, jeez, that is all. Your uncle or that they held on to the VHS then, if that's the kind of year we're talking about. I tried, right about that time, I tried DVD, the rewrite, like recording on DVD. It wasn't the same for me. It was always very hit or miss. But you kind of trusted the VHS to just do it right. Unless it was WrestleMania. I remember WrestleMania 17, it came from my mate's house because he paid for box office and I did not. And it came on two tapes because it long play stopped before the main event and then we had to stay up another night to record the last bit. As well. So it came on two tapes. So Batista, what was it about Batista then?
I don't think there's anything specific. It was just, as soon as I saw him, I was like, you're my guy. I guess like the muscly shoulders, I think that's what I aim for now at the gym, is the muscles on the shoulders. So I think that was the, yes.
He's one of those guys that always seems like terrifyingly humble. Like he's really massive
Oh, nice.
Soft spoken, but could rip your head off if you.
Oh yeah.
Tried.
Like, be nice to him. Like, you wouldn't want to get on the wrong side of him. No way.
So from that point onwards, then you said you had that fallout, and I've had many guests on here say that they've had a fallout of wrestling, which unfortunately, as a fan since I was like 8, I've had like 25 years of nonstop. So I don't know how this fallout happens.
Yeah.
So it was just a case of, it just wasn't cool anymore, or you stopped having access to it. Is there any particular reason why you tried to ditch wrestling for a bit?
I think there were just other things. Like, I started going to high school, so then the high school kind of took over, and like being like a pre-teenager, I was like, I'm not watching wrestling. No. Or like they're trying to be, I don't want to be too much of a tomboy, so I won't watch wrestling because I'd try fit in a bit. That swiftly got kicked out of me, so that's fine.
I get that. I just had my bunch of weird friends, and that was it. I was fine with just going home and watching wrestling, and then going to school and
talking about wrestling.
They didn't even like talking about wrestling. I think I don't know how they put up with me. I think I was reasonably clever. I don't know what happened since then, because here I am. So from that point onwards, going to local shows as well. What do you remember? What your first one was? Do you remember who was on it?
No, I think I went to one in Dundee. So I went to university.
Oh God, okay, that's fine. You don't need to say anymore.
So there was one in Dundee. I remember going to. I don't really remember who was on it. It was just like a small little place.
Yeah,
I had a good time.
If it's who I think it is for being a fan, it is usually good shows, but it's probably not a great place. But it was the Ardler Complex that it was, or do you know, or remember what it was?
Pass. I think it must have been like 7 years ago or something, so it's a long time ago.
Fair enough, that's fine. So independent wrestling, though, this is totally different to WWE. You're not getting the glitz, the glamour, the lights, anything like that, but it's still, you still liked it. It was still a good night out.
Yeah, it's fun having the crowd, because like, especially a Scottish crowd, mm-hmm. if you get a good one, it makes it so much better. Like, no matter, even if you don't know who's wrestling, and like, is this a heel? Is this a face? Like, should I boo him? And like, it doesn't really matter. No one's going to give you like, why are you cheering him? Like, we don't cheer him. So you just do what you want and just let yourself like loose, and it's mm-hmm. so good.
And generally, there's usually a pocket of like regulars that kind of help you dictate who to cheer and boo for.
The first few matches, and they're like, "Right, I'm going to follow you and see what you do."
And then and then someone you like comes out, and they're booing, and you go, "Ah, no, patch you guys."
Here, but I'm not.
So from that point, you said you came back into. Do you remember what was that brought you back into it? What actually got you back into wrestling? Was that WrestleMania or
clips on social media of just like random WWE stuff? And it was around. I think it was around the time. No, it was before. AEW was starting to build, so I was like, "This is interesting." So I think that drew me back to like, I remember liking this, then watching a few. I can't even tell you what pay-per-view it was, but I think I watched one of them and I was like, I don't know why I stopped watching this. Like, this is good. And then just got back into it.
That's it. It's a forever nostalgic factor. Seems to keep bringing you back. I mean, I barely watch any WWE, or I don't watch AEW, but I don't watch any kind of mainstream stuff anymore, but I still kind of know what's happening and keep up to date and all that kind of stuff. It's a weird thing, and then you see like The Rock comes back, and
yes, everyone can't miss when stuff like that happens.
And then, by the time this goes out, WrestleMania will be over, so we don't know if The Rock's a good guy, a bad guy, or what.
We do two takes, going yay!
Congratulations, Cody Rhodes! Commiserations, Cody Rhodes! Your story hasn't ended. But yeah, it always seems to, there's always a way to bring you back into wrestling somehow, some way. It's one of those weird, I don't think people, unless you watch it, people don't get that. It's just intangible. And like I say, going to a show with a crowd as well, and they're all, there's always, again, the pocket that dictate kind of should we boo or cheer? But there's always the other people that are just heavy into it, a man, woman, or child that are just totally invested. They believe in the characters. I mean, I went to a show yesterday, WrestleZone Regal Rumble, and the crowd was just fully invested in those 3 hours, and it was just, yeah. I mean, so was I. That's why my voice sounds like this. It doesn't usually sound this bad. But I spent most of my evening shouting at Ronan King to get back in the ring during the Rumble, and then he lost, and I was furious. But even then, and I've been watching for 25 years, and I'm still that kind of invested as a person to watching wrestling. It's just ridiculous.
I think that's one of the best things about wrestling. Like, you never really, once you're into it, you never lose the excitement for it. You're always going to be rearing for, like, even if it's a match you don't know anyone on. You're still going to enjoy it.
That's it. And then you get to reel people into it as well. Like, I've reeled my wife into it, and she was, her favorite won the Rumble. So I like Caleb Valhalla, but he wasn't my pick to win. So I was really annoyed. But for yourself, then, you grew up, you found people to speak wrestling with as well. Was that important for you? Kind of still had that kind of, I'm assuming you still had that kind of tomboyish reputation for liking wrestling. But you're able to find people. Was that a uni or just before uni that you're able to find a group?
At primary school, there was me and a few friends that used to do wrestling on the trampoline. So we had a wee CD player at the door to play our entrance music. And it had one of, like, the fake replica belts. So we'd wrestle for the fake replica belt.
Right, sack the rest of the questions. I've got more questions about this. Right, that's fine. Who were you? Did you have a character? Were you a
interesting wrestler? I can't remember the name because I sketched it in the belt. It was like Psycho something. I don't know the end, but it was Psycho something. It reminds me of Psycho Courtney, but it was Psycho something. And I was like, I was trying to remember because I thought of this other month, and I mentioned to my mom going, can you remember what I called myself? She was like, no. I was like, damn it.
What kind of belt was it? So a replica belt. What was it?
To be honest, I think it was Intercontinental.
Oh, nice. The one Cody Rhodes brought back, or the Oval, or?
The Oval.
Oh, even better. What a belt that was.
So, it was just like one of, like, the cheaper ones, but I won it, so that made it better.
I'm going to focus this on this a lot because I'm just a belt nerd anyway, a geek about this anyway. Was it the foam one or was it the plastic? Oh man, yeah. Even better. This is this is great. I went to a car boot sale recently and they had a bunch of those belts, like for a fiver or something. And they had a bunch of the like faux leather plastic ones. Those ones got one long side and one short side, which I don't have OCD, but if I had it, that would just drive me insane to look at. But it had a foam belt European title. And I picked it up because even though my son's not even 2 and he's not really interested in wrestling yet, I was like, you're getting that. I mean, I will get that for you.
Yeah, it's definitely
right now. Yeah, exactly. That was it. And it's probably a place in our living room at the moment. So I'm just like, God, I hope you like wrestling because it's such a cool find that I have found here and you're going to love it. Fingers crossed.
You'll like it.
So, for that, I don't know, because you're a bit younger, did you get into anything like message board e-fedding or anything like that, or was it just trampoline wrestling?
Nah, I wasn't really allowed on the internet much. So it was mostly out in the garden.
That's way healthier. E-fedding
I wish it was like that now, to be honest. Sometimes.
You know what, that would be ace, really. Like, it wouldn't, maybe not for bringing in fans, but if there was a wrestler's league of e-fedding, just private, doesn't have to be, we don't need to see it or anything like that, but just to sharpen up the old promo writing and all that kind of stuff, that would be fantastic. Bring back e-fedding. You can bring get Psycho Courtney on the case and get the IC belt back and just...
Get the trampoline out, let's go!
That's it. That's what's missing in wrestling nowadays. We've got all these great companies that do great wrestling, great characters, but there's no trampoline feds that I've seen in Scotland, certainly.
What's missing?
I'm all in on seeing a tribute show or anything like that. I'm I'm fully invested. So anyone out there? Promote, I mean, sorry, Kate Calloway's going to do it. Promoter, we're going to go promote it now. So that's it. You get a trampoline, I will get the belts. I've got a European belt, I'll use that. Yeah, all
get
good.
A CD player for the engine music.
That's it. We'll get it. I've got the 3-disc WWE anthology. we've got this sorted. That's it. That's right. Meeting's begun. We're just going to book this instead. Right. Anyway, no, we're not. So getting back into it. You went to local shows, started in Dundee for your sins, and you did a bit of traveling, though. Did you go to like your ICW and all that kind of stuff in Glasgow? Did you?
I've been to ICW later on. So the last like 3 or 4 years, I've been to some ICW. But back in the day, I didn't travel too far for it, which is, I wish that I did, because it would have been, knowing what it was like now, it would have been amazing. But
it's when you see posters of shows that were like maybe not even an hour away from you from back in the day when you liked wrestling, when you were into wrestling, you think, oh man, it would have cost me so much to get there. And it's just, yeah, it kind of blows your mind, because I know there was a show near me like a year before I got into Scottish wrestling, which was 2012, that had Rory McAllister on it from the Highlanders. And I looked at the poster and went, no, I'll be that tribute stuff. I'll be doing the WWF tribute shows. And it's one of those where I see the poster and go, God, I wish I went to that show. Wish I went to it, because it sounded amazing. So going around then, did you have any favorites before you started training or started thinking of training? Did you have any ones in the local scene or just in general that were just favorites to watch?
Yeah, a few of them. Lizzie Evil, I met once on ICW show. Lovely and amazing. So that was also inspirational. And Molly Spartan was always a big draw for me. ICW shows.
Big shoulders.
Yeah. You see a trend.
Speaking of trend for big shoulders, I did a little bit of research, because that's how we do. I try to anyway on these podcasts. It doesn't always work when cage match doesn't get updated. But I was noticing a couple of your favorites being likes of Rhea Ripley and Jordynne Grace. So there is a bit of a pattern here emerging. Yeah. So what came first then for training to be a wrestler? Did you get into workouts to start the shoulder bulging process? Or was it wrestling that got you into that side of things?
Nah, so when COVID hit and lockdown hit, I started to lose weight because I was at my most unhealthiest. I was my biggest. Wasn't happy. So spent the time trying to lose all the weight. And then once I moved back home, I started the gym. And then, because it was just home workouts during COVID, because everything was shut. Mm-hmm. So it was all like, here, get your steps in at home and like 10-minute abs and stuff like that. Because I was like, I don't know what I'm doing, so I'll just do anything and hopefully it works. So then started at the gym and then realised how fun just lifting heavy things is. So, and then about, I think it was a year, 2 years of the gym. And then I was at a Discovery show. And then Coach Andy was on. And I was like, I feel like I could do this. This would be fun to do. And then my friend was like, he's got a training school, by the way. Like, just up the road. I was like, does he? So on the train home, emailed, can I please start training? And I think I was like within two weeks, had my first class. And like just about a year now, loving it.
I feel like I've seen him a little bit longer than that. So that's the weirdest thing. I don't know whether it is that COVID years kind of just compresses or decompresses
it
years
does.
Now.
It's messed up timelines. It's so strange.
It certainly has. Because when you think about when we were recording this, it was about just over 4 years when everyone was sent home to work. And that's where I've remained. I was sent home March 2020, whatever year, 2020. And that's it. That was me. So everyone did the same things. They either made bread, started a Twitch stream, did a podcast. Hello. And also, yeah, tried to do all these like workout things, your Joe Wicks in the mornings. And I downloaded DDP yoga. I did 2 sessions and wanted to die. And I was like, no, that's it. I'm happy being fat. So I'm just going to keep doing this. I'll be jolly instead. That'll do. I'll be ready for winter. But it was just that weird time. But Gabe, I suppose for you, if you were starting to, maybe the cogs were starting to tick at that point, going, okay, maybe this is something I could do now. I'm getting healthier. I'm doing all these workouts and things and I'm enjoying it. Was there any, I know, I was subconsciously, but you won't know that. Was there any conscious effort of watching some wrestlers? You think, okay, maybe I could, if they could do that, maybe I can do that as well. Like a Jordynne Grace lifting people about and throwing them. You're thinking, yeah, if I was a wrestler, I could, if I was Psycho Courtney, I could do that and add that to my moveset.
I think once I started, and then I started to look at wrestlers different to think, could I do that? Like, I could do that. Like, and like people that were inspirational when I was a kid, being more so now because I'm so much closer. So like, I could, maybe with a bit of work, I could do that. So I think once I started, there definitely was. But when I was just starting, I don't think there was anything subconsciously in my brain about it that I know of. There could have been.
Never know. Never know. But yeah. So yeah, I'm just trying to think of that. So you started the training, like you say, yeah, like you say. Once you start, I've seen a couple seminars, and it does alter your brain chemistry for watching wrestling. Now you kind of watch it with a more logical point where you go, oh, why did they do this? Why did they do that? Yeah. Oh, it did this and went into that. It becomes more of a performance art, but it becomes a bit more of like a play, I suppose, wrestling at that point, because you get to see how the story progresses.
Yeah.
Same time, which is, I find fascinating as a concept. And I suppose after so long, that's how you keep trying to remain invested, and you find new ways to remain invested with it as well. First bumps then. 2 weeks after you sent that email, you got your first intake, first class. Was it everything you expected? Or once it hit, you're like, oh no, I may have made a mistake here.
No, well, my first class, we did a chop circle.
Right, okay.
So we just did a circle and then chopped each other. That was the first class. So if anything was going to scare me off, that would have been it.
you just stand there looking at the person to your left and go, size of your hands. Oh, no. So can I move? Can I get that little person, that little-handed person there? I'll just go there. Go there. They can do it. Okay.
I think I was, if I remember correctly, I think I was the only woman in that session. So the person next to me didn't want to chop me. Because they're like, oh, well, and I was like, no, come on. They're like, right, okay. And they chopped me. I was like, thank you. Ow.
Just goading them now, going, no, hit me.
Don't treat me different. Just hit me. It's fine.
That's it. I mean, when you started watching 2008 or so, it was still the tail end of the Diva era. So it wasn't, you weren't really getting competitive matches. Yeah. You weren't getting any of that. So when you're going into a class and you're the only female there, then that could be quite intimidating. But Did you feel that at all, or like say you're just goading folk just to chop you because you want to be equal on the same stead?
Yeah, I think I've always been around guys more. Like most of my friends growing up have been guys, so I've just been known as like, not to be like that person, but I've always been known as like one of the guys. So I don't really, I don't feel that and like intimidated or anything when it's just me and there's a bunch of guys. I'm like, I don't really care. Just fine.
Do you remember who was in that? Is there anyone in that class that has went on to shows at all? Do you remember?
Who's in that class? I remember Craig Berry being there from Meat Factory because he's the one that chopped me.
I can see Craig being hesitant. He seems like a nice guy. You'd be a little bit hesitant, but
until I was like, come on, it's fine. And he was like, okay. Yeah, he was in that class. There was Roscoe, who started the same the week after me. He was on the showcase in December. He was in the Rumble and the 8-man tag. And Achilles King too, he started the same day as me, also on the showcase, the Rumble and the 8-man tag. There was a lot of other people on this in that class, but could not tell you who they were.
That's fine, good base covering. Just in case someone listens to this and go, I was in that class.
I'm sorry.
So there may be a small queue at the next training session to chop you for forgetting their name. So that's
just
chop queue. Yeah. Chop line, one at a time. So from that, you got into training. Andy's there. She was it just Andy that you're dealing with, or was it Stu as well? And
I think Stu did a few. Like, if Andy couldn't make it, and Stu would take over, but it was mostly Andy.
And I've spoken to Andy before for this podcast, and he's one of those guys, and we've seen it on social media, that he won't ask you to do anything he wouldn't do himself.
Yeah.
Kind of thing. So was he always involved in, if you were doing whatever, I'm going to make this sound really weedy, 50 push-ups, he would be there doing it as well.
Yeah.
Did that help? Do you think that was,
you
got him doing it as well, that you thought, oh, okay, cool, we're all in this together kind of thing?
Yeah, so anything like drills or any learning things we would do, he would always do it first. So you always knew, like, it's not too bad if he's going to do it, so I'm going to be fine. So it was good to be able to see him to do it, because I think if you just said, oh yeah, go do that over there, just do this and do that, right, off you go. I think I'd be like, I don't want to be here.
Yeah.
He's hands on of helping everyone. So if you don't know what you're doing, there's not like a, you should know what you're doing. Come on now. Even if you've done it 30 times before, he's still going to be nice and like, right, I'll help you. Well, let's walk over it again.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's the best way about it. Because I think if I got like 3 or 4 times into it and I was like, I still don't get it, but I don't want to say. I just hide in the corner.
So was there anything that you found that wasn't immediately picked up kind of thing? Was there anything particular, like a, I don't know, running the ropes or anything that you felt like that was your hurdle, your first hurdle in training?
Anything to do with jumps.
Right.
Jumping is always, I'm in training to get better. That sounds stupid, but I'm getting trained better to get jumping. But it's my brain, because the history of my weight, I always feel like I'm heavier than I am. So I'm just so hesitant to jump and not get it. Because I've done stuff like elite frogs and I've managed it fine. But there's always that thing in my head going, I can't jump, so I'm not going to do this.
Mm-hmm.
But I think everything else, it's not been the best the first time. But once I've got some reps in on it, it's always gone better, thankfully.
It's also the thing, I mean, if you went back and watched old wrestling or anything like that, you've seen injuries happen, and generally a lot of them is like your knees, your calves, your ankles, and it's always caused by jumping. Yeah. I don't know if that's also thrown in there somewhere where you're going.
Probably. Even when you watch someone land a jump and they're not injured, you're still like, oh, that must hurt. Like, do you know when you jump and like the pain goes up like your heels and you're like, oh, just watching it on, if anyone jumps from something and lands, you're like, does that hurt? Oh.
So I mentioned like any subconscious inspirations from that point, but once you actually started training and you started doing your heavy lifting and what have you, is that when Jordynne Grace and Rhea Ripley kind of entered the picture of your mind?
Definitely. Definitely. I followed Jordynne Grace a lot more once I started appreciating weightlifting and get into the gym. And then Rhea Ripley also. I was a fan of Rhea Ripley before, but I had more of an appreciation for her once I started gymming myself.
I feel like they've both of them broke the mold on what a women's wrestler should be
Like Beth Phoenix as well. Beth Phoenix was a big one back in the day for me.
Absolutely. I mean, you had Chyna as well way back when, but I think she was kind of, because all the women around her generally were so much smaller than her, she was in the men's division a bit more.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but yeah, Beth Phoenix, absolutely. Even Michelle, I was throwing Michelle McCool as well as someone who was like blonde, yes, and beautiful and all that kind of stuff, but she was tall and she was like, you didn't really see the six pack abs quite a lot in those days and all that kind of thing. So wrestling certainly evolved now where you got someone like a Jordynne Grace who's shorter, but you wouldn't think that.
Yeah.
You think she's like 10 feet tall because of the way she carries herself and her transformation in body.
It's great now that there's such a wide variety of women's wrestlers, because before it was just like back in the day, it was just stick thin, and so it's good that there's such a variety. You don't have to fit a certain mold. You can be yourself and be fine.
Yeah, I mean, just look at the top two companies. I mean, TNA's women's division is still stellar, but WWE, just for the sake of my brain here in argument. But you got Piper Niven on one side, who's bigger bone. You've got Willow Nightingale, AEW as well, who's bigger. And then you've got your more athletic ones. You still got your petite wrestlers like your Alexa Blisses and all that kind of stuff. There is such a scope. And I suppose that helps with yourself as well. You don't have to find particular mold. You could be your own Kate Calloway instead.
Yeah.
Which, you know, makes wrestling better when there's variety, isn't there? Because
definitely.
We can't all like the same thing.
Exactly. And it makes anyone who might be thinking of being a wrestler, you don't have to fit a certain thing. You can go in whatever you want.
As long as you've got the passion and some sort of rhythm, then.
Exactly.
Determination. That's it. Just do it. If you're going to do it, just do it. For myself, I'm microphone happy. I'll stick with that. Every time, like you're saying, when you see people landing and stuff like that, I just look at that and go, no, not for me in the slightest. I get winded when I'm going up the stairs, and I probably should work out, but I'm happy. I'm going for jolly. That's not a healthy way to think about it. It's my way of life now. I'm sure it'll be fine. I'm sure won't have issues in the future. That's tomorrow Billy's issue. Today Billy's fine. He's happy. He's sitting down right now. And if he stands up and his knees crack, that's 1 hour Billy's problem. So he can deal with it. So from that point onwards, how long was it between starting your training and that Christmas showcase then? What was the kind of time scale?
So I started, it is about, I think, 2 weeks until it's the year. So it'd have been April and then December. So I started in April and then the showcase was December.
So that's 8 months you went from starting to debuting.
7 months, yeah.
Which is a pretty fast intense. Time. So were you there as often as you could? How often were you training?
Yeah, I started off once a week. And then once Coach Andy said I could go to the advanced classes, I was twice a week. So I think I was advanced classes, I started April, about August, September, I was doing advanced classes, so I was up to twice a week. And then whenever he would hold the women's only classes, I would go to them. So like every few months or so, which was a smaller group. So you got to do it a lot more. So it was a lot more useful.
Mm-hmm. I suppose with the women's classes as well, you kind of get introduced to probably people that you'll be working with more. Because even though nowadays, I think it's becoming a bit more commonplace where wrestling, just wrestling, men, women, whatever gender choice, whatever you feel, they just all wrestle now. But there is still companies and promotions that'll just go, women's match.
Oh, yeah. You're going to get that, but it is good to just, it's a good place to find new people. As you say, you might be working with, or even just to have as allies if you need them.
Oh, yeah, because wrestling is, the online is still a very toxic culture. Doesn't matter where you go.
Yeah.
Which is fun. you know, go onto Twitter and see what meltdown of the day is happening, or go onto Facebook and see who's calling out who. And
yeah,
as someone who tries to keep out of that stuff, I just sit and read it. That's way more fun for me. But
oh yeah, you read up on it and then you just avoid being in it.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that's it. You like to know what's happening, but you don't want to be in what's happening. That's it. But now you're over the barrier now, so it's probably a whole murky depth that you've seen and don't want to get involved with and all that kind of stuff. Red, not seen. That makes it sound worse. You've read. I'm digging myself a hole. Let's just get out. I'm gonna get out. So debut. When did you find out you were making it? For that amount of time, and you were pushed, you were put into the advanced classes. So again, that's a really short period. So you must be picking it up very quickly, and Andy was trusting you to be able to handle those advanced classes. So how did you find out you were making your debut that weekend? Because I think, was it a twofer? It was the Christmas showcase and then was the night of the wrestling?
The showcase on the Wednesday night, I believe, and then the show on the Thursday. So there was talk of me being on the showcase because there was a rumble. So he wanted as much of the beginners in it as possible to try and get experience being in the ring in front of a crowd. And then I think it must have been about a month or something before, there was talk of me being on the show. And I was like, being on the show? Ooh! And then it was excitement. And then, oh no, I'm going to have to wrestle in front of people. Oh no! Oh no! But I think having the showcase first got all the nervous jitters out.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I really had any. Once I walked through the curtain, it was just a different, like, I don't even know how to explain it. It's like a different person coming out. And then everything that I was thinking just before left, and I was just focused on getting in the ring. And then once I came back, everything came back, all the emotions came back flooding as soon as I came back through. And then the second on the show, I kind of knew what to expect walking out.
Mm-hmm.
So the fear wasn't as strong. There was still a fear, but it wasn't as strong as it could have been if it was just, right, you're going on the show now. So
how much of that month beforehand, how much of Kate Calloway was there? As in, character in mind, your gear, because that's quite a month turnaround. It's probably not ideal if you're finding out you're making your debut. Yeah. So how much was there?
A few months, because I did get, I took a while for my gear, because I got designs made up and then I got it made, so I had to travel through to Glasgow a few times for fittings and getting it made up. It might have been about 2 months before, actually, thinking about the gears and stuff. But there wasn't, once they said I was going to be on the show, I was like, okay, so I've got to figure Kate Calloway out so I know what's going to happen.
Was there a particular, like, when it came to your gears, a lot of blues and golds, I think, Ryan, and a bit of blacks as well. Was there, was a design that you made, was there any, like, particular reason for particular portions of the gear design, or was it a case of you went, I want this colours in here, so I went, here you go, aye, that's ace, let's get.
Well, I gave a colour palette, because I like the light blues, and it's like a super light minty blue, and navy blues, and then I gave some reference pictures of, like, Taya Valkyrie, Beth Phoenix, who else? There's a few others. I have, like, a few other people that I like the gear, and I was like, I like this, can you make something around this, please? Because I like the Beth Phoenix effect with, like, when the cut out in the stomach, but I was like, I don't really want to cut out. I was like, and I want full legs, and I want this, and I want that. So I think it was like 2 or 3 weeks after I said, this is kind of what I want.
Mm-hmm.
Can you help? And then they sent it back and I was like, I am in love. Thank you very much.
And as soon as you said Beth Phoenix, I was like, ah, that's it. Because it's got the kind of, not totally like flared bottom of the bodysuit. But yeah, there's got a little bit of vibe to that. I mean, sliding doors effects here. You mentioned that Taya Valkyrie, that we could have had the massive, like, big fluffy Ugg boots in there as well. But
was contemplating it because that was
next
cool.
time. Next
maybe
time.
Maybe eventually if I come out with the big fluffies, then you know.
What a sentence to put out.
That's the slogan for this podcast.
That's it. Kate Calloway, if I come out with the fluffies, you know. Yeah. Right. I think the tech issues has really just relaxed me maybe too much in this podcast. That I'm just going, yeah, right, that's hilarious. Fluffies, let's go. Yeah. Maybe it's the chocolate because it's Easter Sunday. I had a mini eggs cheesecake earlier. It was amazing, but I think it might be the sugar rush that's kind of hitting me now. So, I mean, if we're on for another 15 minutes, you can see me crash as well, which will be hilarious for everyone. So, like, you mentioned that like the kind of showcase took a little bit of the nerve away for the next show. I never thought about that when I'm like looking at results, but that's like a genius thing that I'm assuming Andy or Andy and Hannah or whoever's involved with booking and that's an incredible idea because it does that exact thing where if you're going to have first show jitters, get out of the way of the showcase show when you're in front of your friends and family and other people's friends and families, and then next night that's wiped slate clean and you're in your proper debut.
Yeah, first night won't be as harsh critics there, so yeah. If I'm locked up it would be okay.
It's all right. I think I might be the only Scottish wrestling writer. It's fine. I haven't been to one yet, but it's on my list. PWR PRO is on my list of promotions. It's a case of finding time. That's the weirdest thing nowadays. We had 4 years of, well, 2 years until things opened up again of all the time in the world. Now,
yeah. No time to do anything. I don't have any time for this.
Exactly.
Especially so much, right? There's a lot of wrestling to try and watch.
So much. Like start of the pandemic, I watched every WWE pay-per-view live because, you know, I could, and I could come to work in this office, look like utter shit, and I'll be fine. I still do that, but I don't watch the pay-per-views the night before. I just now just look like utter shit. But so it's, and now shows are back open. You're like, oh, no, I can't stay up. If I don't stay up to watch it, I'm not going to watch it now. And it's just a whole thing. So by the time this comes out, I'll probably up was 19th of April, I said it's going to be. I'll probably still be recovering from two nights of WrestleMania. I don't think my body's ready for it anymore. It's
that's the thing, not having as much experience now, meaning it's going to be hard.
That's it. I did a year and a half worth of staying up once a month, all night, to the Thunderdome, which was incredible for many reasons, good and bad. Nowadays, yeah, when this comes out, yeah, I'll probably still be recovering from WrestleMania when Cody wins or. Shame Cody lost and delete as appropriate. Oh, I can't believe they came back in Raw. That was incredible.
I can't believe it.
I was you know those moments where you're about to say a name and you think nope, and then you can't think of another name because they've been cancelled and you're like nope, not them. Oh god, that's really blank to me now because I was thinking of trying say somebody. No, I can't.
That's the thing, though. Someone asks you, "Oh, even music." It's like, "Oh, what's your favorite song?" I'm like, all the songs leave your brain. So everyone's like, "Oh, but I say wrestler." I'm like, aren't there any wrestlers? I don't think there are. Not in my brain.
You do one of those A to Z's, and you go, "Can't think of anyone for A." Unfortunately, nope, they're all gone. There's nobody who starts with A. Nobody at all. Proper that has really rocked me because I've really just went and the first name it is anyway, right, move on. So towards the night of the wrestling too, you were announced for the Fatal 5-Way. You gotta do a promo as well, which was all the promos coming up to it were all Christmas-ish related, and you had Christmas Carol, or the best version, a Muppets Christmas Carol.
Yeah.
As your kind of theme for it.
Yeah.
How was that putting together?
It was good. It was my first promo, so it was an experience to have. I think it was good that I had some sort of structure that to kind of follow, so I wasn't just make a promo and I'm like, I don't know what I'm doing. Because even though you watch all the promos in the world, you're still like, I don't know what I'm doing. So it was good to have some sort of structure to follow and then just making it care towards myself. Mm-hmm. It was a lot of fun to make, to be honest. It was so fun.
It's always like you don't want to get into the trap of going, so-and-so, I respect you, but I will beat you kind of thing. You just want to just jazz it up a little bit. Because I don't know if you remember, I don't know if you watch OSW Review, but they did the thing about the Royal Rumble, and there's always 29 men, 30 men, last man standing. There's always a trope of lines and everyone. And nowadays I'm watching promos, I'm like, oh, don't say that.
Yeah,
it's like, you haven't fallen into the trap yet of doing promos in cars. Don't know how that started. I don't like it. People just stop it. Stop doing promos in cars.
I technically did, but it was all part of.
Yeah, that's it. It was part of the thing. Yeah. Well, you've just done the promo in your car. Is it the acoustics? Is that the thing?
Maybe we're missing out.
Maybe. If wrestlers that do promos in their car, let me know. Is it just the acoustics? Or have you just went, oh shit, I've got a promo that needs to go out tonight. I'm in the car. Do it. I respect you. I will beat you.
Man, I don't win.
Twas a night of wrestling too, though. Fatal 5-Way. What a lineup that you're in with. It was quite a terrifying lineup, to be honest, for your first proper go. How was it for you? Didn't win, but how was it for you?
Didn't win, but it was incredible. It was, I think, for the next hour or two after it, I was still shaking because I was like, I can't believe I've just done that. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. And I didn't muck anything up. Like, it was all good. It was, Charlie didn't win, but it was so much fun. And it was, to say that my debut match was with Daisy Jenkins, Ashley Vega, and Emerson Jane.
That's pretty good, right?
Yeah.
Because if I'm putting a top five wrestlers, especially female wrestlers in the country right now, they're in there straight away.
Definitely. I'm so lucky to be able to be in that match. I'm so lucky.
And it's one of the marquee matches of Power Pro or 5-Pro Wrestling Asylum. It's one of their marquee matches. So, and you're going in with, like I said, Daisy Jenkins, who came through Power Pro as well, who's just a freak athlete. I don't know if it's, I think I spoke to her a couple of times. I think it's just because she's not here for a long time, she's here for a good time kind of thing. She started her later.
Yeah.
Ashley Vega, who's just a consistent, just workhorse. I don't know what she does outside of wrestling, because she doesn't seem to do anything outside of wrestling except wrestling. And Emerson Jane, who I've watched since 2012 and is just incredible. And you're in there. I mean, I can see why you'd be nervous, but at least you had the first night to kind of get some of the nerves out of you. So when it comes to, did you get any feedback after the show? Or I don't need to know the exact details, because that's prying a bit too much. But were you making sure to seek feedback from the likes of Emerson?
Definitely. I got backstage and I didn't jump on straight away, because I let you all deal with your own stuff and relax. So then once everyone had calmed down a bit, I was like, so feedback, please. Like, even if it's really bad, just tell me so I can work on it. Just anything.
Sandwich it. Give me two good things and put something bad in the middle. That's what makes it better.
So I was asking pretty much anyone, not just everyone in the 5-Way, it was anyone that was on the show that was watching. Coach Andy, just any feedback I can get, just to keep getting better, really.
Yeah, I mean, because like we were saying, wrestling is a variety show, people will like different things, so if you're talking to someone who's got the opinion of they don't like this kind of thing in wrestling, you might find someone who does like it, so it's
someone else will love it, so you just take stuff with a pinch of salt, really. I take it under advisement. Like, you don't like it, other people might not like it. Do I want to change this? Not really. Okay, next thing.
I mean, you must have impressed enough, though, that you were in the next Fatal 5-Way as well. With a rule change. So clearly they feared Kate Calloway, that's sort of a gauntlet instead. And I didn't really have the results for it because I'm all the way up in the Northeast. But were you in the first match with Daisy? Was that?
Yeah, I was right. first out with Daisy. Yeah.
So no pressure.
No.
Being the first
not
one.
At all.
Did you find after you got the double out the way that when it came to the next one, that, and that's technically your first singles match, wouldn't it? In the concept of the gauntlet.
Yeah.
So you've done Rumbles, you did that multi-person match, and now you're into a quote-unquote singles match. How did you feel that was a different kind of beast? You didn't have as many bodies to kind of take into account. It was just you and Daisy. Was that?
Yeah, I think that it simplified it for myself anyway, not having to worry about so many people at once. I could focus on her. So that did make it a lot simpler, thankfully. And you got to focus on it and just make anything that I did even better instead of focusing on everything else.
Yeah. So like the yin and yang of it is going, yeah, you can focus on one person, but you're doing all of the hurting. You're getting hurt the most. So, it's just one of those things. So, so that's the dawn of power. Got the gauntlet, and that's kind of the first proper, I mean, the name change came just before Twas the Night of the Wrestling 2. This was the first proper Power Pro Wrestling show. Did you feel there was a difference, the change in colours? Did you feel that there was a different feel, a vibe to Power Pro once they changed scheme?
I think so. I think I felt stronger. I felt more wrestling company that also trains people rather than training school that does shows. Yeah. I did feel a lot stronger. But looking back now, like, it doesn't feel like it ever was. I always feel like it's always been Power Pro.
Yeah.
I feel like it's grown so much in such a little time. I feel like it's been Power Pro for way longer than it has.
Yeah. I mean, I suppose when it initially started, it was an offshoot of Glasgow Pro Wrestling Asylum. And it had the same kind of logo style in that. So becoming Power Pro gave it its own identity at the same time. So it kind of became its own promotion, which for likes of people involved, say, gives you your own kind of home turf with Power Pro. I mean, going forward, I don't have any matches noted coming up for Kate Calloway, but is there any promotions that you're maybe have an eye on, or are you kind of just, you're a year in, are you just wanting to get your feet settled first?
I think getting my feet settled, getting as many reps as I can in with Power Pro, but eventually going to likes of like Disco, of where that made me want to be a wrestler, a full circle moment would be good.
And am I right in thinking, again, brief research here, that you did actually meet Jordynne Grace?
I did.
But I don't know about that.
Yep. So we went to, when they came over to Glasgow for the TV show, or Impact as it was then. But so I went to the show in Glasgow, and then they were set. I bought a T-shirt before. I pre-ordered it, so I went and collected it, and then they said there was meet and greets. So I was like, I'm gonna have to, because you could meet them and get a photograph. I think it was a signature or a photograph or both. And I was like, I want a photograph, please. So after the show, it was like up the stairs. So I went up the stairs and I was like, try to find her. And I took a moment when I seen her, because I was like, she's right there. Oh no, she's right there. And then she was so lovely. Because you never know, especially after like a full day, you don't know how someone's going to be. So I'm like, please don't be a bell end. Please don't be a bell end. Like, please, please don't ruin this for me. Loveliest person. She's like, because I was like, you are my wrestling goals and my muscle goals. Then she said, like, you're my height goals. I was like, good. So we just talked about the gym, talked about wrestling, got our photo, and then she was like, oh, let's get a selfie too. So we got a good selfie, and my heart was so happy. I don't think I shut up about it for months after it.
And now we're on a podcast, and I've brought it up, so I'll give you a chance to speak about it again.
I don't think I was... bring it up as often because people just give me the look.
Like, we know. That's it. I think we're now in a generation of wrestling. I mean, back in Andy's day, for example, it wasn't the thing to get the picture. Nowadays, you weren't really allowed to go meet wrestlers and get a picture with them and all that kind of stuff. But I think we're now in a more accepted age where things like, I was going to go into a very deep hole here, but like mental health matters and all that kind of stuff, that just have that little bit of joy getting a picture with someone that's a hero, you know, just for, if that's your moment to have that bit moment of joy, just take it kind of thing and get the picture.
It's not too much effort on their part.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's going to make someone so happy for like 2 seconds of your day, at least, like, it's totally worth it.
Absolutely. And I'm glad of all the, I mean, I've thrown shit in here in this whole podcast, but I'm liking the first kind of curse you went for was Bellend. I appreciate that just as a podcast host and as a human, because you don't hear that word awful lot up in the Northeast. We throw different kind of weird Gaelic words at people. Thank God, Jordynne Grace. I don't think I've ever heard a bad word about Jordynne Grace from people meeting her and being involved around her at all, which is good to hear. I mean, I don't know if you've ever had any negative experiences meeting wrestlers at all in your brief time going to shows.
I don't know if I've got it here, but I remember my dad took me to like a show. I think it was like Cowden and Beath or something, and there was like a fake Undertaker. So I'm in the ring with like my wee Batista t-shirt on, like the fake Undertaker. It's like on like the wee, like, what's it called? What's the name? But the wee photo you print out.
Oh, the Polaroid.
Yeah. So I've got the Polaroid of it, of me standing in the ring with like the fake Undertaker in Cowden Beath.
Hold the phone here. So we've already talked about trampoline wrestling. Now you've been to a tribute show. I don't want to like just scrap everything that we've talked about your actual wrestling career, because you're a wrestler now. But tribute shows. Do you have any other memories other than the photo with the fake?
Oh no, I had to ask where it was because I have no more other memories. But I was looking through boxes of old stuff and I was like, oh my goodness, look at that.
I bet the Undertaker.
I bet the Undertaker.
I mean, was that the inspiration for the name?
No, it wasn't. And I didn't even think about it until, I think it was a few weeks after, I'd got the name, I'd got the logo, and they're like, oh, you try to be like Undertaker, are you? And I was like, what? And I was like, oh, wait. Oh, no. Damn it. It's a lucky coincidence, I think.
The granddaughter of the Undertaker, coming soon to show. Anyway, right. So going forward, then, like I say, disco seems to be your bucket list one of how it got into wrestling.
Yeah.
And that's where you want a place where you want to go to. You've wrestled probably some of the best women's wrestlers in the country as of now. Again, bucket list. Is there anyone local or I can guess who the international ones are, certainly. Jordynne Grace, you know, apparently you've met her. That's just a secret. Nobody knows. Is there anyone that you immediately go, yes? Lizzie Evo, I'm guessing, is going to throw in.
Molly Spartan. Rio.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Danny Luna. Is also a very good name. Harley Hudson, too.
And I'm going to assume you want to get Craig Berry chopped at some point as well.
Oh, of course. I did try and ramble in the showcase, but then he eliminated me, so.
He's got two strikes against him now, then.
I know.
He did send in a question, though. We got a question from Craig Berry. And where is it? Technology is not my part tonight. There it goes. Right. He sent a very simple question. What's your favourite meat?
I'm going to say, there's two ways I go through this answer.
Go for it.
See, John Kerr. Just so it's not him. Are we Alfie? But was, the honorary Meat Factory member, Alfie. So we'll go Alfie. Just to, so it's not Craig.
Cat amongst the pigeons and all that. Yeah. Sorry, if you thought this was a chaotic podcast, the first time I spoke to Craig, I started naming his nicknames could be something berries, you know, like Craig Strawberry, could be a farmer. I, you know, I had, that's just how the sometimes these podcasts go, you know, sugar. So. We're all right. We're fine, though. We're still alive. We're okay.
No crash yet. We're fine.
No crashing. We'll be okay. We're fine. So, yeah, favorite meat, you're choosing Alfie just to throw a cat amongst the pigeons.
Yeah.
I half thought when you sent that question in, I was going to ask that question and look like a right idiot when you go, I'm vegan. And I'm just going to go,
oh, okay.
Oh, no.
Next question.
But you can't be. You haven't told me. You're not, though, are you? Just...
No, I'm not.
Oh, that's okay. I didn't want to do all that little bit there, and you just go, oh, yes, I am, and I'm just, like, casually offending you as I'm going in the podcast.
No.
So we've talked about your promos, talked about where you want to be and what you want, who you want to wrestle and all that kind of stuff. Is there anything that is there that you're thinking, right, 5 years' time, I'll be 6 years into wrestling, I want to have accomplished this? Is it title aspirations, so you can maybe retire the Intercontinental Championship with Psycho Courtney written on it, or like a company that you would like, you mentioned Disco, but is there, if you could get into, I don't know, a gut check and maybe TNA being an option, is there anything on that bucket list, or are you just kind of taking it as it comes?
I think all of those would be amazing, but at the minute, just taking it how it goes. I think if the gut check does come back and I'm at that level where I think I could go for it, definitely. Likes of ICW would be amazing too. But at the minute, it's just see where it goes and try and have fun while doing it.
That's all you can hope for. I have taken up about an hour of your time, so I think we're gonna wrap up. Otherwise, who knows what kind of tangents we're going to spin off into and how many people I can offend at the same time. But it has been an absolute blast speaking to you. Where can people find out more about Kate Calloway?
Be on my Instagram, Kate Calloway PW, X or Twitter, depending on how you want to call it. Again, Kate Calloway PW. We've also got a Facebook page and the PWR PRO page as well. You'll find me popping up there.
I think Elon needs to just take out the trademark of X or Twitter or whatever it's called now, because that's what just everyone seems to call it.
Yeah. You say one, you're like, no, wait, should it be the other one? No, wait, no, I don't know. Just say both. Simple.
Yeah. Have you got a TikTok?
No, I've been thinking about it. So maybe.
By the time this comes out, 19th of April, we may have
a search. There might be one.
There we go. Hashtag something. Ah, no, I'm too old for that. Anyway, right. Thank you very much for speaking to me today. This has been a chaotic episode. I think that's probably the best way to put it. A chaotic. No, that's not going to work. Let's just move on. But yeah, thank you very much for speaking to me today. I'm going to go for a lie down. I think that might be the best. But yeah, great. Thank you.
Thank you.